Great to be home and preaching, ministering the word here. Last Sunday, I was up in our Hills Church with Pastor David Bland, who's one of our favourites, and he was here for many years, and the Hills Church is doing great. You got to see the number of kids they've got. They're full of children. So I think it's about 200 people in the church, and I reckon 70 of them are children under the age of 12. So when the kids went out of the service for the children's program and the parents took them to sign in, I said, well, who's left? So thankfully they all started coming back. But it's great. And keep them in your prayers, our daughter churches. And we're very linked together. They're not independent of us. They're an extension of us. And so keep them in your prayers. And I visit them at least once a year, sometimes twice a year. More than conquerors. Now, over the last few Sundays, we have been encouraged to become more than conquerors in 2017. And we're gaining insights from the readings of the book of Joshua, the Old Testament book that we're reading for January as part of our life journals, and also the New Testament letter to the Ephesians, which we start, I think, next week. And that covers our January readings. The good news is that we can experience real victory in Christ, and we can overcome through Christ the limitations that were inherent in our old life that held us back, that bound us, that controlled us. And that comes as we get to know the God of great promises. And the book of Joshua is full of great promises. The letter to the Ephesians is full of great promises, great things that God says about you and me, who we are in Christ and what we have received through Christ's life, death, resurrection, and what he's continually giving and doing in us because he's alive and through the Holy Spirit ministers to us. And also by moving forward with confident and courageous faith in this God who is good and loves to provide for us. And by living in God's priceless and powerful word. And I trust that Pastor Jeremy still blessed you last week when he shared about the word. Isn't that right? I haven't listened to it yet. I haven't watched it on our Christian Family Center TV station. Is that what we have? It's called CFC TV. Is it? What's it called? Family Center TV on YouTube. Is it right? And we also have our own app, don't we? And that's, so I'm going to watch it this week because people have said to me, Jeremy's message was great. So if you miss any of our Sunday messages, by Monday night, Tuesday, you can actually watch them and enter in and receive, so you don't miss out on any message that's proclaimed here. So today, our fourth week in the series, I'm sharing about developing a new mindset that views all of life from God's perspective. So let's read this one verse which you may have missed when you read Joshua chapter 1 on New Year's Day. And most of us stayed up fairly late the night before, so it might have gone in one eyeball and out the other as we read that chapter. But this is a great verse. As Joshua and the Hebrew people are getting ready to cross the River Jordan to possess the land that had been promised to the Hebrew people. So God had given them the promises, says the land's yours. Hundreds of years before, and he kept reaffirming the promise. And he challenged them, said, okay, guys, the promise to be fulfilled, you've got to take faith steps, action. You've got to move. You've got to trust my word. It's not just reading my word and believing it. You've got to act upon it. And so as they're getting ready to cross the Jordan, the Lord reminds Joshua, and Joshua reminds the people that they've got to get their think tank, their mind, and their emotional center under control, because that can circumvent the operation of faith that wants to step out and outwork, receive and outwork the promises that God has. And so he says these words in Joshua 1 verse 9, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. And he says these words three times in chapter 1. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. So he's saying, your mind, your emotions, somehow you've got to get them agreeing with God. You've got to get them under control. You've got to police them.
Don't be afraid. Do not be discouraged. God's with you. Moses is dead. I was with Moses, but you're alive. I'm with you. You've got the promises. You've got to step out in faith, but you've got to get this thing under control. So why a new mindset? Why do we need a new mindset? Well, because a forward-moving faith can't be maintained in the long term. You won't be able to maintain it unless you develop a positive mental attitude. And God knew that the children of Israel would not make it if fear took control of their thoughts and their emotions, and particularly when they realized how many enemies they had to face. So in Joshua 3 verse 10 and Joshua 12 verse 24, we get a list, 7 enemy nations and 31 enemy kings, and each of them were evil, and each of them had an army. So you imagine, you're at the River Jordan, Moses has been your great leader, and you've watched him for 40 years leading you, delivering you out of Egypt, bondage there for 400 years. They've moved into the wilderness, and now he's dead, Josh is alive. They formed an army. I mean, these guys are young boys now. The old generation had gone. The Moses generation had finished. Joshua bridged the two. So now, and they're looking at 31 kings, and each of them has an army, and 7 enemy nations. So no wonder the Lord is saying to them, guys, be strong, be courageous. He goes, don't fear. Get this thing under control. I'm with you. And so they had a lot of enemies. Now, we as Christians and as a church, we have enemies. And they will try to oppose your every move forward in Christ. You start possessing the promises of God. You start really doing this stuff. So not just reading the Bible, but isolating the promises and then believing them intellectually. And we talked about what faith is. It's knowledge, it's belief, but then trust. You start stepping out and outworking the promises and saying, I'm actually going to experience victory. Your every forward move, as you move forward, the enemy is not going to like that. He doesn't mind you reading the Bible and saying, isn't that a nice book? He doesn't mind you saying, well, actually, I believe it's all true. But he minds when you take it seriously and say, okay, now I'm going to jump out of the plane and I'm going to pull that parachute cord. I'm going to trust in the words that I have believed, and I'm going to be a parachutist. I'm going to be a flyer. I'm going to activate this faith of mine, and I'm going to experience the victory. I'm going to king hit the enemy, and I'm going to overcome. I'm going to take possession of all the land that is rightfully mine that is now illegally occupied by this trespasser. So he will oppose you to try and gain victory. And as a church, as we move forward, when we talk about vision in February, I mean, we're talking about not... We've been going for 40 years. We've had our 40-year celebrations, but really, we're thinking of the next 40 years. We're looking at the Joshua generation being raised up and saying, okay, how many new churches? How many new missionaries? How many new pastors, leaders? How many new ministries to touch the needs of our immediate community and to help bless our other local churches? So we know that as we think this way and as we step forward, the enemy will oppose us. And the Apostle Paul describes this beautifully in Ephesians chapter 6. I love this. And the final couple of verses, or as he introduces spiritual warfare, he says, finally, Ephesians 6, be strong in the Lord. This is like Joshua speaking. And in his mighty power, put on the full armor of God. So as Joshua armed his men, he says, now we've got to put on the spiritual armor so that you can take your stand against the devil's what? Schemes, deceits. He is tricky and he's sneaky. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. You're not fighting people, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realm. So he identifies, says, guys, you're in a struggle. And the metaphor that he's using is not just, he's using two metaphors, one of a Roman soldier, fully armed, and he goes into this a bit later in Ephesians, but he's also using the metaphor of Greco-Roman wrestling. And Greco-Roman wrestling was terrible. It was a shocker. So, I mean, I love ancient Greek culture, the good parts, or some parts were shockers. So these guys in the Olympics would fight to the death. Fight to the death. Fully naked. No women were allowed. And I mean, it's like body, a sweating, horrible body over you. It's like, he says, we wrestle not against the struggle. We wrestle not against. And sometimes demons are like that, evil spirits. It's like we're wrestling with them. And it's like, you've got to throw them off. And you can't just say, you just got to pick them up and throw them off in Jesus' name. So I have nothing to do with you. Jesus said that when the devil came to tempt him. He says, get away. I've got nothing to do with you. We've got nothing in common. Nothing in common, light and darkness. But it is a struggle. And Paul alludes to this. Now, our mind, along with our emotions, hear me on this one. This is a very important point. You don't get anything else in today's message. It is the control factor as to whether you can, by faith, take hold of the great promises of God and experience His powerful presence and peace and provisions. The key to this is our attitudes. And it's possible by a little mental discipline to change the attitude of our mind. And folks, it's within your power to choose what attitude of mind you can take on board. No devil can stop you. Okay? No devil can stop you. Your mind is free. Your emotions are free. Your will is free. Okay? Now, the devil may endeavor to hinder, and things in our past can try and restrict us, but we are free to actually choose once we know who we now are in Christ. If you know who you are in Christ and you know what you have through Christ, and you're saying, okay, I'm going to take those promises and by faith I'm going to outwork them, because the devil and your own past can't restrict you. However, your mind and your emotions, which bridge the spiritual and the natural. Our bodies are physical. It's a sensuous body. We have senses and we interact with our physical world. Our spirit also has senses. We tap into the spiritual world. Our mind can cross both. So I can be talking to you now and I can be thinking another thought, okay? I can be sitting in my office and thinking and placing myself in Papua New Guinea. Amazing what the mind can do. Memory, thoughts. It's metaphysical, I know, but it bridges both the spiritual and the natural world. And you know what? God does a miracle on the inside of us by placing His Holy Spirit. He saved us through Christ's death on a cross for us, and Christ rose again, and He sent the Holy Spirit, and He does what we cannot do. But God can't change our mind. He doesn't actually talk about, I will change your mind. He says, I'll change your heart. I'll change the orientation of your life. I'll give you what you cannot receive. But you're responsible now what you do with your think tank and how you handle your emotions. And you might need counseling. You might need some medical help. You might need, and that's why we have all these healing provisions so that people's minds and emotions can be healed and brought under control so they can enjoy the fullness of life today. And the scripture gives us some fantastic statements here. And so let's read a couple of these. Let me just read some New Testament scriptures taken from Ephesians and other places. Romans 12:2, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Ephesians 4:23, be made new in the attitude of your mind. Notice that transformation comes, newness is experienced. 1 Peter 1:3, I love this. Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Be self-controlled. I think the King Jimmy version says, gird up the loins of your mind. Gird up the loins of your mind. And literally, the Greek word is rein it in. It has the image that you need reins on your mind. So your mind is like a wild stallion. So those horses that win the Melbourne Cup, I mean, unless they're reined in, they're just wild. Brumbies and Brumbies are next to useless except for dog meat and cat meat. Can't do anything with them. It's wild. They tear down fences, eat the wrong grass. But so you got to break them in. And when you break them in, they become useful. And how do you break them in? You put reins on them, little bits, the saddle, and you can put it. And then that horse can be used for amazing purpose, not just for races. That's just kid stuff. I mean real work. On farms and the, our whole economy in Australia was built on the jolly horse before rail came in. And those animals had to be reined in. And Peter is saying, your mind is like a wild stallion. All the potential in the world, But you ain't going to achieve anything unless you rein it in. And as Christians, only then can we take the great promises of God and by faith outwork them when our think tank and our emotions are reined in, so not hinder the flow of what God wants to do in and through us. Philippians 4:8, I love this one. Paul says, guys, you've got to control your thinking and you've got to think about certain things and you've got to reject some thoughts. Like he says, I want you to think about such things. If you're going to function in the Christian life, you've got to think about noble, right, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, praiseworthy things. If you're going to appropriate God's presence and peace, you've got to make these the subject of careful reflection. You've got to reject some things, the opposite of these things, which will block you realizing God's presence and power and peace and provision. Ignoble things, wrong things, impure things, horrible things, unworthy things, poor things, negative things, critically destructive things. I was talking to somebody in the coffee lounge after the morning service, and we're talking about a situation where this person is so negative and critical. It's like, man, you feel like having a wash afterwards. Like, no, and you just know that if someone's just critical, they can't think of a nice word to say about a person. And they're just picking on the fault, or they're finding fault with the church, or they're finding fault with this. It's like, if you let internal critical, you be a critical person, that you're always looking for fault, and you're always seeing the bottle, the glass half empty, you're not going to realize your potential. It's obvious. All the promises in the world from the Lord, and all the faith that you may muster to outwork those promises, you're going to block what God wants to do because the filter is so messed up. So that's why Paul says, hey, control your thinking. Think about such things. Philippians 2:5 says, your attitude should be the same as that of Jesus. In other words, humility and love. Humbling ourselves before God and loving people. That's the attitude of life. And 2 Corinthians 10:5, I love this one. Take every thought captive to make it obedient to Christ. How's that? Spiritual warfare for the Christian involves every thought. Every thought that opposes Jesus and is not in people's interest or is not in your best interest. We just don't let any thought come into our minds. If a thought comes in that's demeaning to myself as a human being made in God's image, redeemed by Christ's blood, why would I keep that? Or a thought that's speaking ill or thinking ill of another person, why would I keep that in? Or a thought that doesn't glorify Jesus. No, we take captive. Hey, that thought came in. Where'd that thought come from? Hey, you can't stop the birds from flying around, but you can jolly well stop them building a nest on your head. And some of you have got such good hair there, you're a target. Some of you, the birds go, whoop, what happened there? There's nothing there. Seriously. You can shoo those birds away, but you can stop them. Building a nest, making their home. You don't have to accept every jolly thought that comes your way. Take it captive. I'm not going to think that way. That's wrong. That's against Jesus. That's against that person. That's against my best interests. So life is not about what happens to you so much, but how you react to it. Because folks, bad things happen to good people. We've all experienced that. And what gets up my nose a bit is at times when that's happening, good things are happening to bad people. You think, And part of us goes, I wish you could get it in the neck. He's a bad person. He seems to be prospering. Oh, you can't go that way. You can't hate, can't resent. You just realise the rain falls on the just and the unjust. God's sun shines all over the world upon the righteous and the unrighteous. And so it's how when we react negatively, we get the worst out of life. But when we respond positively, we get the best out of life. Do you know the difference between optimists and pessimists? Well, the optimists choose to see the best rather than the worst. Optimists believe more is going for them than against them. In the cold storms of life, pessimists see icy streets. Optimists put on ice skates. Here's a good definition of pseudo-optimism. This young girl brings home this boy that wants to take her out for a date. And the young man she brings home, he's just really grubby. He's got tattoos in every part of his body. He's got piercings everywhere. And their beautiful daughters bring this human being into their home, and they go, man. So the mother takes the daughter aside and says, honey, we're concerned about your date. Your dad's locked in the study. He doesn't want to come out because he's going to say something. He just doesn't seem very nice. And the girl goes, Mom, because if he wasn't nice, would he be doing 5,000 hours of free community service? Hey, the 8:30 crowd never got it. They just stood there and go, too early in the morning, Hey, the pessimist light at the end of the tunnel is an oncoming train. The pessimist only sees the problems of life, whereas the optimist sees problems as an opportunity to grow and mature, because optimists are solution-oriented. The optimism in one sense, listen to me on this one, optimism doesn't change anything, okay? It doesn't have miraculous power. But in another sense, it changes everything, because my perspective changes. And I'm thinking along a different line. So your imagination is so powerful. You have a powerful imagination. If you imagine yourself as a weak, defeated person, a broken reed, then that's what you'll become, if that's the image you have of yourself. However, if you imagine yourself as being in the process, through Christ, of becoming a strong, supportive, vitally alive human being, then that is what you will become. Your thinking, what you believe about yourself in Christ, makes a huge amount of difference. Remember the 10 spies, the 12 spies that Moses sent out on a reconnaissance mission. So you read it in the book of Numbers. So Joshua and Caleb, fantastic. In fact, someone at the 8:30 service gave me a prophecy about Caleb for me, which was really great. I just thought, he just said, look, I really felt this. So if you have a really positive prophecy, a word for me, give it. But if it's a negative one, keep it to yourself. So Moses sends them out, says, guys, go into the land and check it all out and see. Well, 10 of them came back, and look what they said. We seem, Numbers 13, 30, we seemed like grasshoppers in our own eyes. And then one day, it dawned upon me that how fear multiplies and misinterprets every situation. It has a multiplier effect. And he goes, and we look the same to them. How the heck did they know what they were thinking about them? One, they never introduced themselves to them because they would have been killed. They're spies. But somehow fear had so misinterpreted, they just said, and that's what they think of us. And Joshua and Caleb come back and say, excuse me, boys. We grew up in the same families. We've been under Moses. We've been on the same mission trip. And what are you guys seeing? He goes, we see a land flowing with milk and honey, just like was promised. What's the matter with you guys? All what you see are the bees and the bulls. You're going to get gnawed and you get stung. Hey, when you got milk and honey, you've got to have bees and you've got to have bulls. That's part of life. Where there's great things and good things, there's also some negative things out there. And so the mental attitudes of the two were totally different. Look at Numbers 14:9. This is what Joshua and Caleb said, their positive report. Do not be afraid of the people. They reported back to Moses. Because we will devour them. We're going to eat them up. We're going to crunch those grasshoppers. Their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them. Wow. Solomon said, as a man thinks in his heart or in his mind, so is he. Proverbs 23:7. Jesus said in Matthew 12:34, out of the abundance or overflow of the inner life, the heart, the mind, the mouth speaks. George Bernard Shaw, the great philosopher and writer, said this, reasonable men adapt themselves to their environment. Unreasonable men adapt their environments to themselves. Therefore, all progress depends upon the efforts of unreasonable men. Ha, that's a good one. Joshua and Caleb were unreasonable men. They refused to accept the natural reasonings that their circumstances dictated. They knew there were 31 enemy kings there. They knew there were 7 hostile nations. They had the facts. They didn't deny the facts. Faith doesn't deny the reality of what is. It looks beyond to the promise of God. It says, I believe God. And I'm not going to trust what my own mind says and my own emotions tell me, because otherwise I'll be manipulated by my moods and my mind can, and if I don't take every thought captive, I can be taken captive by some strange notion and thought. There's no way. I believe God. And they acted as if it was a fait accompli. It was theirs. The what ifs need to loom larger in our consciousness than the why nots. Some people see things as they are and they ask why. I see things, George Bernard Shaw said, a great statement, I see things that aren't and ask why not. To develop a positive mindset, to say, you know what, our best years are ahead of us. We've planted a stack of daughter churches. We want to plant twice that number of churches in the next generation. We want to touch other nations in the world in our world mission strategy. We want to see ministries develop from this church that are going to affect our city of Adelaide to a much more powerful degree than what we've seen in the first 40 years. We rejoice in what God has done, but we're looking forward to what God wants to do as we take hold of his promises. And as the new Joshua generation rises up, man, they outdid the Moses generation in some respects. They really did. They possessed the land. They took it. The only difference between weak and strong people are the ideas that grip them and the dreams that possess them. Ultimately, there are no great people, just ordinary people like you and me who have an extraordinary commitment to outstanding ideas and dreams. Amazing. I mean, they inaugurated Donald J. Trump yesterday. And you think, what seemed impossible? Everyone thought, no, crazy Donald. It's not going to happen. But if you dig a little bit deeper, he outdid every Republican nominee. He's not really a Republican Party member. He outdid the Democratic Party. And have a look, he had a big idea. A big idea that he's held for 25 years, has possessed his soul. And they said to him, are you ever going to run for president? Ah, no, too busy making money. Now he's 70, doesn't need to make any more money. Possessed by an idea. Here is a very fallible human being. Here is a man with a lot of foibles. And man, we need to pray that he really gets saved and understands the sanctifying power of God to deliver him from that. But I tell you, it's an example of the power of an idea. You compare him to Hillary Clinton, if you follow it. She had no idea. There was no bold dream. Didn't energize people at all. Whereas Bernie, who was 74, this old socialist, he kind of lit up a fire. So here are these two old boys possessed with ideas and people believe them. Now, whether they're the right ideas, who knows? The jury's out. But don't underestimate the power of an idea that grips your soul, of a dream that possesses you. And if it's a God idea, if it's a godly dream, man, there's nothing that can restrict you and hold you back. God has already dreamed up the most incredible things for your life. Tap into these dreams. He has so many positive promises from his word. That's why I produced this little bookmark. And I gave it out to you the first Sunday. If you haven't received it, I think we've got copies at the back there. Take one from the usher. And what God says about us, the promises. You're a forgiven, cleansed human being from sin. You're without blemish. You're free from accusation. You've been delivered and set free from the old life. You're a new creation. You're a child of God. You're accepted by God. You're made righteous. You're God's workmanship. You're complete in Christ. You're enthroned with Christ. You have the power, presence, and peace of God in your life. You have a healing covenant to draw from. You have God's material supply to tap into. You have authority over all the power of Satan. You're more than a conqueror. Hey, these things have got to be owned by us in our minds and grafted within. So we have a new image of ourselves. And there are dozens and dozens of more of those scriptures. That's why I've written the book, The Me I Can Be, and we're going to launch it in 2 Sundays' time. People are saying, I want a copy now. Just wait a couple of weeks. The reason why, there's probably, I counted about 70, 80 of these promises that we've put in. Chapter 1's all about who I am now in Christ, the powerful promises of God. And I've listed a whole stack of these promises. That bookmark, just a few of them. And then at the end of that, the wonderful story of of Penny Hamble, who shared with us the first Sunday of the new year, and she shared with us up in the Hills Church last week and moved our hearts again. Of she knows what she was, she knows what was done to her, she knows how there was a cursed influence, no fault of her own, but now what she's become through Jesus Christ is like a totally different person, because she believed the promises, impregnated them into her inner life, and the imagination was changed. She deprogrammed all that rotten stuff that was sown in, and she got free. Chapter 2 is about how we walk with God. How do you take the wealth to walk? And I got Pastor Steve Sherman, who was one of our CFC pastors, planted a church at Aberfoyle Park, and we amalgamated that with the Hills Church, and Steve's now a pastor up in Stirling with Pastor Hahn. So his story and his walk, it's just interesting how he struggled. He's thinking he's got to walk to please God, and had to get to the place of understanding grace. And so we've got to know how to walk with God in grace to experience victory. And then chapter 3 is all about how do we get a new mindset. And the testimony of that one is from my own dear wife. And many of you have heard her story in bits and pieces. And in fact, I've said to Cathy, she should write a book and really share the story, because it's a miracle story. And then I got Pastor Phil Bryce sharing chapter 5 about how God provides. Just a little testimony of provision, of how good God is, even in the small things of life. And how he. And then chapter 6, Pastor Ray Betcher shares his story of being delivered and healed from childhood trauma. And so the aim with those stories is that when people get the book, and if they make contact with me and we're setting up a web page, I'll put them onto the Rose people and say, listen, you need to talk to Ray, you need to talk to Kathy, you need to talk to Jim. And so I want it to be a vehicle by which people can understand all the potential that is theirs now in Christ can be realized, and it's a practical guide to victory. When Nikki, my daughter, read it, she said, Dad, I need more chapters. And then she realized, no, the aim is under 100 pages. It's a guide to overcome. It's a guide to victory. I share my own story of the first few years. And so to share with us today, my wife's going to talk about a new mindset and how she got healed of something that was a terrible thing that occurred in her life. Sweetheart, come and share.
Hello, everyone. I think it's on.
Yeah.
I just thought I might read you the first paragraph of my story in the book, just to start off, so bear with me. Sometimes when children come from a family background where the atmosphere is toxic or chaotic, violent or abusive, they learn very helpful and life-saving ways to preserve their mental health and physical safety. Their emotions tell them they're not safe, and this formulates their thinking, which leads to actions of self-preservation. These tools of resilience are their greatest strength as they grow, but become stumbling blocks in adolescence, mainly because it's not the truth. Often they become stunted in adulthood, repeating behaviours that are unhelpful, immature, and deadly for personal happiness and successful relationships. Such is my story. Then I go on to give my story. Eldest of 7 children, a second family, 5 children in the first marriage, so 12 siblings. A father who was incredibly abusive and violent, who was also a fairly significant church member and ministry. We had a lot of problems in our home because my mother had us before they were married, and in the 50s that was a pretty bad thing. Brought a lot of shame, a lot of guilt. Never dealt with, swept under the carpet, and so therefore the problems festered. She came from an abusive family of her own, and so never dealt with anything. So when I was growing up, to protect myself, I used to withdraw, was very passive, but incredibly angry. And I remember as a child, apart from physical beatings, like terrible, sitting on top of me and hitting me in the face with the heel of his shoe, those types of beatings, he would sit at the table when we had dinner as a family at night time and systematically go around the table and be verbally abusive to us. And I remember when I was about 12, deciding that I was no longer going to tolerate this, and I would just get up and walk away from the table. And then that set off a series of events where my parents decided that I was demon-possessed because I wouldn't submit to them. And so they, on one occasion, forced me into a room and prayed deliverance over me. So it was spiritual abuse as well. And so I grew up believing that to be loved, I had to be perfect and never say anything and just be passive. And inside was this incredible rage that there was no outlet for me. I felt passed over, unloved. There was nowhere for me to go and no one to understand me because it was all hidden. But at the same time, I really loved God and I wanted to serve him. I was filled with the Holy Spirit when I was 8 years of age, just on my own in my bedroom, after a terrible family event when God's presence was just so real to me. So I took myself to Bible college when I was 17, knowing that I wanted to serve God for the rest of my life. I chose a man to marry, knowing that we would be in ministry because that's what I wanted. I wanted God. But at the same time, I had this area of my life that was completely in a fog of mystery and confusion and depression because I couldn't break free from having this terrible polarization in my life of hating what my family was and wanting to follow Christ, but at the same time preserving my own self by wrong thinking and keeping myself safe through destructive behaviours. The crux of it was that I really didn't believe in my heart that God loved me, and it was a situation where I just could not accept that he was my loving father, even though I verbalised it and I could say it. And so there was no trust there to trust him with my life. And so control was a huge thing, manipulation, control, just rabid boundaries around myself that I wouldn't let anyone get past and wouldn't allow myself to go into their world either and understand and empathise. Anyway, I'd like to say, guys, that this is a simple thing and that somehow God came down and touched me and I was healed one day, and I wasn't. I never have been. It's been a struggle, exactly like Bill has said. It's a change of mind. It's a relearning, a refashioning of the very fabric of who you are. And it's counterintuitive to how you think. If you protect yourself, it's really hard to actually step forward. It's very hard to let down barriers if you have learnt that that's the way you keep yourself safe. It's very hard to let someone in when you are angry and unforgiving. And it's only through the cross and realising that God sent Jesus. And when they spat on him and broke his back and hung him on a tree, he still loved them. Yeah. It's an amazing thing. And so, as I've learnt to trust him and throw out those evil thoughts where the devil would seek to destroy us, if the devil could destroy us, he can hurt so many people. So I'm sure that's his tactic. So not only is it throwing out that evil influence, but it's also changing in here. And to do that means that I've had to give up control. It's not me that can be in control. It has to be God, that when my mind is foggy, when I'm depressed and I can't see any way through, that I cannot trust my emotions. I cannot trust my feelings. I have to go to the Word of God. And to go to the Word of God, I've got to know it, and I've got to believe it, and I've got to trust in it. And I have to speak in a heavenly language every day so that the Spirit washes me and cleanses me. I've done that through journaling. I do a lot of journaling where I can be quite angry and upset and distressed, and I'll just sit down, and within a short period of time, as I pour out my thoughts to God and even tell Him when I'm angry with Him, because He hasn't given me the happy life I think I should have, which is wrong thinking, that He comes in and that peace comes in, and I'm changed and my thinking changes. And you know, it's a new lifestyle, it's a new habit. It's saying, I cannot be trusted, but He can. And it's doing the opposite of what your emotions tell you that you need to do. Losing control of your own thoughts and your own thoughts, standing against the devil, and taking responsibility to renew your own mind. It's really important. You have to take responsibility. If you say it's somebody else's fault, I can't say anymore that my behaviour is my mum's fault or my dad's fault. I have to say it's mine, and I have to own it and claim it and change my thinking. And by the grace of God, He's helped me through. Thank you.
Yeah, great. And when you read the full chapter, in fact, I said to Cathy, she probably needs to write a book of 5 or 6 chapters, because there's so many lessons there to be made. You know, when Jimmy Vasos shared his story, Pastor Jim Vasos, 2 weeks ago, and remember what he said if you weren't here? He was a young boy. Now, I led him to Christ in the high school revival back in 1972. And he had a significant mental breakdown. He was hospitalized for several months. And a doctor, unwisely, probably based on the facts, said, son, you're going to be in and out of hospital all your life. You'll never be able to marry, have kids, hold a job down. And they were cursed words by an authority figure. Not deliberately to hurt him. He's giving the facts. And he had to go to another psychiatrist, Dr. John Court, beautiful Christian man, top psychiatrist from Flinders University. And John interviewed him and for him to get a job. And John said, he's one of the most sane people I've ever met. And he got a job, and he got the top job in telecom, became a top engineer, electronics engineer, married a beautiful girl, fantastic children, grandkids, became a pastor after he finished the telecom. And he refused to be defined by what other people said. But you know, Jimmy has said, now with Jim, he talked about his deliverance. There was a need to cast out some terribly evil spirits that were there, that were harassing him. And I was involved in that. It was quite a dramatic story. But Jimmy would say, you know what, dealing with the enemy is easy. Healing the sick body is easy for God. Casting out an evil spirit is easy. Converting a person's heart is easy. Biggest problem God has with us is our believing and our thinking processes. And Jim said it's been a lifetime of retraining his thoughts, and his wife was so helpful for him that he's been able to live actually above medication, which is quite miraculous with the kind of diagnosis he received. And I said to Jim, you got to write that story up. I said, not just what you put in my book. I said, you got to write that story to give hope to people as a man who's achieved, and to say, look, all things are possible to him who believes. It's through Christ. He causes us to triumph, Paul says. We become more than overcomers through Him. All of His promises are yes and positive, and we say the amen, we agree to it. And so whatever your circumstance may be, my prayer is that you would, at a fundamental level, come to a point and say, you know what, I can overcome. I can experience victory. I will experience victory. And so maybe even today, with what Cath has shared and just what I'm saying about developing a new mindset, God has been speaking to you, that maybe you've been accommodating things in your life that you shouldn't accommodate. Oh, that's just me. That's just who I am. But it goes against you being the new creation in Christ. And when you read chapter 2 of my book, you'll see what is required of us as new creation. And you line up and say, oh, my conduct doesn't match up to what God says I should be. Because you're saying, but I can't be that. No, you can't be in your own strength, but you can be through Christ. That's the difference. So if you've been accommodating things, or if you've been kind of compromising with the enemy, he won't trouble you if you compromise with him. But the moment you declare and say, no, 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 we have nothing in common, I'm going forward, I'm claiming that promise for me, for my family, for my kids, and I had to do that. I had to actually make that promise. I had to claim the promises of God to cut off my family from the negatives that were coming through this other family of origin, because I knew what would happen. It would destroy me, destroy my children. So we had to make a very firm decision, Kath and I, to say we've got to love, we've got to forgive, but we actually have to protect ourselves by getting a new mindset, and it's incompatible with that previous way of behaving. And so you've got to stand up and you've got to assert yourself. Certain things are right, certain things are wrong. And don't accommodate the things of the world. Don't compromise with the enemy. Victory is yours. You can overcome. But sometimes it's a journey. And that's why the book is there, to help people to say, okay, this is a guide how to gain victory. And you may need support and help. And that's why I think the testimonies. And so when you talk to Pastor Ray Betcher and his story of how a worker sexually abused him, and his father beat the boy up, he's 7 years of age, he didn't know what to do. It's a crazy thing. And Ray ultimately ended up looking after his dad and loving him through, but the injury it caused him and how he got free, it's a powerful story. A Penny Hamball story, Jim's story, Cathy's story. So we need stories of people who have walked it, who have lived it, and who have learnt to overcome. And so I trust that today you're going to stand up and say, you know what? I'm going to overcome. I want to be victorious. I want to be all that Christ has created me to be. And I'm not going to miss out on any of the blessings that he has predestined for me to grab hold and to enjoy, and with support, prayer, faith, counselors. And sometimes people need to have medical and psychological professionals. I send people to medical doctors and psychologists, psychiatrists all the time. Because I say, you know what? I don't know enough about how that works. I know how the spirit works. And so we work with them. And I said to, again, somebody in the foyer before, I said, isn't it marvelous how God so loves people, so loves the world, and he so hates sickness, he so hates sin, he so hates dysfunction, that he provides all these healing disciplines, all these amazing men and women, and whether they're Christian or non-Christian, and they're experts in their field. Why? Because God hates dysfunction and sickness and sin and evil and abuse, and he wants to provide help to people, and he has these experts. So I'll send people to non-Christians who are experts in their field to overcome an addiction or to break something from dysfunction. If they're good people, and they don't say anything that contravenes Christ or the scripture, and most don't, of course. And so I just think, isn't God good? He provides all these amazing ways by which we can live in this corrupt world that's full of sin and darkness. That's why heaven's not going to have any sin, no devil, no sickness, no dysfunction, no beatings, no rape, no nothing like that. It's going to be what it should have been in the Garden of Eden before Adam and Eve decided to go their own way. And what a God we have that provides these amazing ministries of healing to our world. And what an amazing God that he loves this world so much that he actually became one of us and experienced abuse. All the various abuses that people experience, our Lord and Saviour Jesus experienced. You think, no, he didn't experience that. Yep, he did. any kind of abuse that is possible, Jesus of Nazareth experienced it. Wow. He identified with us. He walked with us in our sin and degradation, yet he never sinned. And so he became the sacrifice. He took all the sins and all the guilt and all the shame and all the fear upon himself. And now this resurrected Lord provides salvation and freedom and healing of our souls. And he can heal your soul. He can save you from eternal destruction and bring healing into your life. He can help you today, and he'll give you a hope that will last forever. Can we stand together?